Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the main event.
Let's go.
Round one. Fight.
Thank you for tuning in to the Crypto Street Podcast. Here are your hosts, Killer Whale, Prince, and Crypto Dale.
And remember to tip your waitress.
Welcome, everybody, to the latest episode of Crypto Street Pod. This is your host, Killer, taking place of Dale for today. Dale couldn't join us today, but he'll be back soon. So send him your well wishes if you do get a chance. Here, as always, with my buddy, Prince. Prince, how you doing, bud?
Not too shabby. Just been watching a lot of baseball tonight. Watching a little Bitcoin price action. Overall, pretty chill. Chill evening.
Cool. I guess we'll skip the weather report. I think everybody can probably guess.
You want to skip the weather report? Like, it was actually kind of nice out. It was raining last night, and now it's just really sunny, and you know, windows are open, shorts are on, flip flops. It's nice. Probably gonna hail or something next week. So you know,
sweet dude, that's good to hear.
Enjoy it while I can.
Anyway, folks, our special guest today is a repeat guest. Everybody liked it the first time we had on, so obviously we had to ask him back. Please welcome Bitcoin Birch back to the show. How you doing, Birch?
Hey, what's going on, guys? Thank you very much for having me. Big fan of the show. Very glad I have an opportunity to get back on and chat with you guys. So thanks.
So how's your night going? You're still kind of working away, right?
Yeah. You guys caught me at the office here tonight. At least a couple nights a week. You know, we try to put out content, you know, at a later hour, right? Because crypto, the glory of it, the beauty of it, it's global, it's everywhere, it's always 24/7. And so, as you guys can relate, not a lot of sleep, not a lot of regular scheduling. It's a lot of flexibility, and I like it. I'm very grateful to have the opportunity. So. I'm drinking a whiskey, and you know what I learned today? I'm drinking because it's a Tuesday night. You know, and so there's no other time, better time. And I learned, and this could be Crypto Biggie. So I learned this from Crypto Biggie if it's total bullshit. But he told me that bourbon, or at least the bullet bourbon, the stuff that I'm drinking right now, which is, you know, bottom shelf, mid shelf stuff, 40 grams of protein, zero carbs, and some fat in like 2 ounces or something. I mean, why aren't we chugging these things after the gym, guys? This is...
This probably fits right on that whole keto.
Yeah, it's keto 101. This is crypto trader friendly, guys. This is,
you know what? I'd really love to believe that. However, I don't know if I can corroborate that. I'm not like a whiskey scientist by any means, so I could be wrong. But like, I want to believe, but
we have the strength of the internet at our fingertips. I just refuse to Google it because I just want to believe. I want to go down believing that.
I don't know if I want to go on the internet to look it up. Because honestly, you know what? I was on the internet a long ago and I was like, you know, I got this lump on my chest. Like, what the hell is this, right? Look it up. Of course, it's telling me right away I got male breast cancer, which only 1% of the male population will get.
It's either that or you're pregnant.
Yeah. So I'm like, oh, okay. Well, I guess this lump on my chest is breast cancer. So there's that.
I like how you go male breast cancer too.
I guess there it is a thing. Like, I didn't even know it was a thing, right? And I'm looking, of course, you know, but lump on chest, and you know, whatever, I just think it's a heat thing, whatever. But it's like, oh yeah, male breast cancer, approximately 1% of the male population will get it. And it's like, oh, this is good to see, Google.
And the next thing you think is like, yeah, I'm for sure in that 1%. You know, I'm unlucky enough. Like, fuck me, right?
Yeah.
Oh, gosh.
Anyway, a very interesting tidbit, Birch, about the whiskey.
Yeah. It's a good way to kick it off. I usually talk whiskey on Wednesdays, but that show was canceled. So this is the only place that I can discuss.
Yeah. That makes sense. Cool. So, I mean... I think you had like a more corporate job prior to going full-time crypto with Bravado and such. How has the lifestyle change been? Because I think it's something a lot of people dream about, is quitting like a corporate job and going full-time into something they really want to pursue. How has that been for you?
Yeah, man. So, you know, I made a career in sales. I'm not an expert in anything but sales, is what I'll tell people. You know, I just turned 30, so I can say that now. I put in my 10,000 hours. I built some cool programs. I had a lot of success. But I was always really intrigued by the financial markets. I was always intrigued as a sales guy. I made commission for my whole life. So I was always trying to make money, right? So I was always into trading in some capacity, or at least learning about it. I dabbled in Forex, things like that. And that's how I got into into crypto. But when I was working, I had my dream job, man. I was working for a cool internet startup in Chicago. I was working for, I mean, we're talking a company that has beer on tap, you know, hammocks and unlimited vacation time. And I was working in leadership, right? So it wasn't like I was grinding the phone every day. Well, I wasn't the one out there making sales. I was managing the people who were and making a lot of money doing it, stock options, you know, basically the life that I had dreamed of for so many years. I mean, this is what I worked towards, right? And then so I got into crypto and, you know, we shared the story last time, but like late 2015, just to gamble, but it didn't really hit me until early last year, like early 2017, late 2016, that this was going to be something, right? That this was, I was certainly not a super early adopter where in 2013, I allegedly lost my hard drive, but I really knew Bitcoin was going to crush. Like that's not what happened for me. And so when the opportunity presented itself, when I had done well enough to actually leave my job, it was terrifying, right? It was absolutely gut-wrenching and terrifying. I'd been there for 5 years. I had made friends and family. And I was going to, basically when I was quitting, I didn't have, like Bravado wasn't making money. Like that was never the goal there either. We were just an open form trading group. And so for me, it was like, can I make 0.1 Bitcoin a day on MEX? Like that was what I had to ask myself. Can I scrape 0.1 Bitcoin a day on MEX and send it over to GDAX and pay myself that way? And even though I had done pretty well flipping shit coins, I wasn't sure as a trader if I was going to be able to make that happen. To answer your question though, what's the lifestyle like now? You know, it's still terrifying. It's still something where every day it's like, it's not kicking your feet up and like, hey, you know, I quit my job and now I live this great crypto trading lifestyle. And it's, I mean, obviously too, the last 6 months have been shit. And so that's definitely made it a lot more stressful, no doubt. And I might kick my feet up a little bit more if we were in a bull market, but it's made me a much, much better trader and investor. And I think person, it's made me more appreciative. It's taught me a lot of lessons. But it's, listen, I'm not just kicking, you know, it's 9 o'clock at night here and I'm at my office and I'm putting out content. So if you're thinking about quitting your job for crypto, right? If you're thinking about doing this full time, don't do it for the wrong reasons. You know what I'm saying? Do it because you absolutely love this space. And as you guys can attest, you know, with a lot of the bigger guys on Twitter, and you have to live in this world 24/7 to break out, for people to know you. And the fact of the matter is, most people don't have what it takes to do that. They just don't have that same passion. So
it needs to turn into, it's almost like a unhealthy obsession at times, I would say, like at least with me anyways.
Well, dude, and I've always heard too from successful people that in order to really make it, you have to be obsessed. And people will disagree with that, okay? And we can have that conversation on Twitter, but you have to be obsessed with what you're doing. You have to outwork the people around you. And you have to be willing to do whatever it takes. And if you're trying to force it, like crypto is not always that fun, right? Like losing money and getting wrecked in a bear market is not super fun. So if you don't have like a larger vision, or if you're not well prepared, or if you're rushing it, or if you're doing it the wrong way, it's you're gonna wish you had that job back. You know what I'm saying? So I encourage everyone to follow their dreams and work for themselves if that's something that they want to do. But there's also nothing wrong with having a job. There's nothing wrong, especially if you're doing something that you love, working a career that you love. So
yeah, I guess in some senses, full time crypto is more work, but work you hopefully enjoy a lot more and is less like soul sucking. Would you agree with that?
Yes, because entrepreneurs were historically the only people crazy enough to quit a 40-hour a week job to work 80 hours a week for themselves. And Twitter, or not Twitter, sorry, but crypto. See, the two are just the same for me, synonymous now. Crypto traders, if you will, and really passionate crypto enthusiasts and investors are the same way. They're the only people crazy enough to. You have to be crazy. I mean, you got to be crazy to be successful in this space. You got to work around the clock. You got to blow.
There's so much risk, and you know, and all of it. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. The risk profile is insane, especially because how many people out there are really properly hedged? Like, I didn't start properly hedging myself until I quit my job because I had to hedge. And so I opened a short and started taking fiat and things like that because I had to, because I quit my job and it just worked out.
I think that's like one of the most enjoyable parts of, you know, maybe the journey through managing a portfolio, and especially you know, for a lot of us, we're young guys, and I don't really think a lot of us, it's not like we come from managing portfolios or something. So the whole journey itself, you know, it's quite interesting because, you know, as your balance grows, you know, you might be able to trade a certain way when your portfolio is a lot smaller, and then it starts to expand, and it's like, okay, well, do I really want all this exposure in one market, you know? And I'm, you know, this market is, you know, my, you know, where everything is for me, but do I want all that exposure? And so that process, that evolution, you know, of just growing as a trader, it's kind of, it's fun because you do, you know, you start expanding, you start, you know, I know, like I went out into different markets through Bitcoin because it was like, you know, I've done something here that I didn't expect to do. So let's try to protect it a bit here because I know this is such a risky space.
No doubt. And if you can succeed trading crypto, you feel like you can crush Forex. Like that's a joke, right? Yeah. But and that's not necessarily, I'm not saying that's true. In fact, a lot of those markets are really, really challenging to trade because you're competing with robots, right? So more so than you are in crypto, especially shitcoins. I mean, algo trading is running rampant on Bitcoin right now, but not so much on your average altcoin. And so it's a lot more just fundamental plays. Who gets the news first? You know, who shills it the hardest? We're still so early in the space. That's just the reality, right? That's the world we live in right now. But I love it. I wouldn't have it any other way.
Yeah, I wouldn't want to be anywhere else, really. You know, it's like if I could look at everything and it's like, you know, if I could be in one spot, I'm happy where I am. Like, I want to be here in crypto, you know? So, yeah.
I'd rather go down with the ship than not have gotten on.
You know? Yeah, exactly. Right.
Something I was talking with a buddy of mine today. Shout out, Joe. Who I met in Chicago, coincidentally, actually, at a little meetup. So Chicago is an amazing city. I love it. Anyway, we were talking about how crypto is such a dense subject matter and there's so much happening in it all the time that if you're almost not doing it full time, you're getting behind really, really quickly because there's so much going on. There's so much new information. There are so many new developments that you have to be on this stuff constantly or else the feeling of getting left behind by what people are talking about on Twitter, what people are writing about on the internet is incredible, you know, and it sets in super quickly.
Dude, you're so right. And you know what? That's actually a really good segue because I've had real life friends and just other people I've connected with in the space. And they've asked me straight up, just how do you do it, right? Or how do you find success in the space? And how have you been able to... The reality is I've always been a really big believer in surrounding myself with people who are better than me and smarter than me and everything else, right? I am not the best trader out there. Not technically, not fundamentally. I'm simply not experienced enough. I've only been trading full-time for maybe a little over a year. I've only been in this space for 3 years. So I am a complete noob. I'm further along than a lot of people, but that is not my expertise. I am not a blockchain technology expert either. I couldn't tell you how to build a... That's not my expert. So why do I outperform people who do have that expertise? They don't put in 17 and 18 hours a day. And it's just that simple. I'm surrounded by 10 other people who put in 18 hours a day. I put in 18 hours a day and we can just do it more. And so it's not always about being the best technical trader. I'll make more money in this market than a lot of people who are a lot better at trading, managing risk than me. Not to say that's exclusively and will always be the case, but that's what I've found. People who I know are better than me, who are dabbling an hour or two a day looking through charts. I eat, sleep, and breathe this. And so that's why also it benefits people to follow other people in this space. People give a lot of shit to pay. Oh, your paid group this, your paid. I can out trade your paid group. Shut up, dude. Like we're like at the end, of, like I got 20 analysts who do this full time. And all we do is look at shit coins. That's why we find the ones that do well. Not always, you don't never lose, but you do well. And other groups that are set up similarly, Dog Pound, Dojo, some others that I really, really like are successful for the same reason. It's because there's 10, 15, 20 dudes working together all the time. Not just dudes, by the way, there's definitely women involved as well. And just doing well because this is what we do. We eat, sleep, and breathe it. And yeah, you might be a better trader than me. Good for you, bro. I bought Ether at $12. I don't know.
I got so much respect for that though. Like that whole, like that comment where, you know, you recognize, like you say, you know, I'm not the greatest of traders. I haven't been trading that long, you know, and like, I love that because you're aware of that. You fully recognize that. And, you know, you pretty much, like you just said, you know, just put the work in.
And how many gurus are out there, right? And they're like 20-year-old kids who are teaching you like the way to do it. Like this is the way to, and it's like you read that on Investopedia, changed a few words around, put it on Twitter. Like that doesn't make you an expert. And if you work at it, you'll get it. But you know what? Back to the $12 Ether thing. Yeah, I bought a lot of Ether at $12. I'd been in the space for about a year at that point. But I also lost over 250 Ethereum trying to swing trade that shit. So, and that was back when it was worth nothing, right? So, you know, I also learned lessons the hard way. And so I think I do an okay job of helping steer other people clear some of the mistakes I made. I went all in on shitcoins before. I also went all in on AndShares at $3. So that's worked out to my benefit in the past, but I've also gotten wrecked. And so it's experience, it's time, it's energy, it's a combination of things.
I think like what you said is very key. Just you have to learn from it, you know? You have to, because if you're the type of person that's always making excuses for yourself, then you're not going to realize the mistakes you've made and be able to adjust those in the future. So I think it's really a matter of having just kind of a brain that works like that, you know, in some ways where it's like, okay, I fucked up, you know, and being able to be honest with yourself about that. And not everybody has that. It's kind of rare, I think.
And you know, being in this market, like especially, you know, because I remember seeing Ethereum around $12 too. And I think, you know, we were very, in a sense, blessed to be in the market we were in because, you know, like myself, you know, I'm not an expert trader or anything. I haven't been doing this for years or anything. So I'm going to make mistakes. And like you said, like with yourself, I lost a shit ton of money when Ethereum was down, you know, below $20, you know, Bitcoin was below $700. I lost a shit ton of money in those stages, right? But, you know, we were very fortunate, and I think we all realized that, you know, we were given a market where we could make mistakes and be aware of those. And then, you know, we were able to make it back because it's like, okay, this market is nice for us right now. And so we were able to kind of, you know, run, fall on our face a bit and get up, and we were able to keep going, right?
So what do you tell new people who literally, I mean, so many people now, so the Twitter salt right now is at all-time high levels, right? I would be salty too if I was down 70% on my investment. So what do we tell those people, right?
You just keep giving her. You just got to keep trying. Like, you know, it sucks. It's like, and the worst part is because when you're down, it's real, right? You're down money. You're down your own money that you probably worked hard for, right? And I remember, you know, even myself just, you know, getting liquidated on BitMEX consistently over and over, right? And finally, kind of, okay, well, maybe I shouldn't do this, but I'm still going to try. Maybe I'm not going to try right away because I'm not going to be a total degenerate. But, you know, I'm going to reevaluate things, and I'm going to put a plan into, you know, place.
It's like, don't quit entirely, but maybe take a different approach and be able to recognize that there are problems in your strategy. I would also just say something I would tell people as well is you're still pretty early, you know, in the whole grand scheme of things. So it's, you got in at a crappy time. If you got in January or December, it definitely sucks. You know, there's no way around that. I mean, obviously you're feeling like shit, but I would also say, I can't tell you how many top traders we've talked to on this show that say their initial like foray into crypto was buying the bubble in like 2013, November of 13. Yeah, buying Bitcoin at like $1,100. And then it crashed immediately and they lost everything they had. And these are like some of the best traders where we've noticed this pattern. Like we've kind of talked about this amongst ourselves too. Almost without fail, like the very best traders we've had got absolutely destroyed the second they started. Because it gives you a perspective.
I haven't ever talked to a single person who is successful in the markets who hasn't gotten completely destroyed at, you know, multiple points really when they're starting out.
Dude, that's actually, I didn't really think of that, but yeah, you're totally right. A lot of the people we look at as OGs, a lot of people that we respect for being early adopters lost everything. I mean, even people who might, I mean, think of people who really, like Charlie Shrem is a good example. I mean, dude went to prison and he was just forward thinking, right? Like I don't know enough about the whole story to make a smart comment about it, other than the fact that I'm pretty sure he like isn't a super terrible dude who deserved to go to prison. I think he's just like very early in the space
and I think he
got caught with like money. I think it was money laundering through a technicality, yeah, absolutely crazy. And so that's a really good point. Yeah, if you're down 70% right now, that's not when you sell. That's just not when you sell. You like at that, I've had so many people like, I think I'm just going to pull out and just wait now. Just wait and see. Well, then you're just going to buy back in when it pumps another 30%. The emotional trauma is already there and you've been able to survive this long. If you can afford to position in, that's like one of the best things I ever learned was dollar cost averaging. And I'll never forget when I put my first $5,000 into crypto. I was lucky. I didn't buy the top of that bubble. Actually, my first Bitcoin I ever bought was late. Like again, it was 2015. It was $400. It had already crashed at that point. But when I started trying to learn how to trade, and what I did was I went on Baby Pips, the site that I learned for Forex, and I started trying to trade candles on GDAX, literally like Ethereum candles when Ethereum was $10, $12 and just getting wrecked. I lost 70% of my stack just by being a bad trader. And one of my buddies was like, well, how much did you put in? I was like $5,000. It wasn't a lot, but like, damn, I'm down to like 1500. He was like, put in another $5,000. And I was like, why would I do that? He's like, cause now you're average. Now you bought at half the price. And I'm like, oh yeah, it makes sense. Mm-hmm. Rest is history. Mm-hmm.
So what do you think of the markets right now? We have Bitcoin at like 7,600, I believe, as of recording this.
Yeah. 7,618. So yeah, so I've been pretty public with my larger. So I'm trying to coin that. Maybe you guys can help me, but I'm trying to coin the phrase swing hodler. I like to call myself. Yeah, I'm a swing hodler now. Because trader, you know, I trade, but that's just, it's over you. I'm a swing hodler. And so basically, my point is I'm trying to play these much larger windows. That's something I've tried to get a lot better at, is playing market cycles, right? And so I did not short 10K. Though I was pretty adamant that the psychological resistance there would hold up, and I just didn't put my money where my mouth was. But I did short 8,500 or so, and I held that down to the bottom of this symmetrical triangle that you see all over Twitter right now. That symmetrical triangle is one that I've been kind of watching for a while as well. Technically, it's actually pretty bearish, but we won't get into that. But the point is, I had some bids. The bottom of the symmetrical triangle was like 7K, and I was like, you know what? Putting my money where my mouth is, I'm going to scale bids between 7,100 and 6,800. I got filled at 7,116, and it bounced back up to a previous horizontal resistance that I had drawn out and again shared, and that was at like 7,700. And I closed it at 70, and I just put my money where my mouth is, and I just closed it, and I was really, really profitable. At that point, we saw a dip down to 75. And yesterday, my degenerate ass opened a 50x leverage long on BitMEX just for fun, just for shits, because I was pretty confident today we were going to have a nice fat candle. And what happened was I went to bed. I was up 30% on my 50x long, which meant that the price moved like not much, obviously, a couple of percentage points. And I woke up and there was a big red candle, and I was like, all right, well, my liquidation price is 76.33. That was my, or rather, 74.33 was my lick price. BitMEX hit 74, like 44. $10 above my liquidation price. But you know what happened to Bitcoin Birch? He got liquidated anyways because BitMEX don't care. And so so I got liquidated. I'm like, all right, that's sweet. I did another degenerate 25X long, opened it this morning, popped a big green candle, scalped profits, and then just said, you know, F this, I'm out of here for the day. And I haven't got back to BitMEX. What do I think of the market right now? I think without a doubt, 100%, the market is all in unison. And so what I mean by that is like Bully made a tweet, your favorite green jacket. Bully made a tweet earlier. He's old enough to remember a time when alts and Bitcoin were inversely correlated. Did you guys see that? And yeah, totally. Yeah. That wasn't that long ago. That was, you know, this time last year, maybe a little bit after. So we're not in that position right now. And so I'm not doing much TA on many alts or many other coins. Mm-hmm. If Bitcoin's going to go up, alts are going to go up with it. And if Bitcoin's going to go down, alts are going to get wrecked with it. And I believe that will continue to hold true until Bitcoin breaks out of this symmetrical triangle one way or another. I don't know how much more wrecked alts can get. So if Bitcoin dumps, they may hold BTC value pretty well on average, especially some of the ones that are the lower cap, like probably sub 25, sub 50 million market cap coins. And if Bitcoin breaks up out of the symmetrical triangle, which will be a price between 8,700 and 9K, and it starts to get really bullish, I think you'll start to see that inverse correlation again. What do I personally think is going to happen? I personally think that we will move upwards from where we're at now. I think there's enough momentum to carry us upwards and I'm probably going to close my long at like 8,500 and see what happens and kind of reevaluate. So I'm not really prepared to say that we're going to moon from here, but it is really, really hard to be bearish much longer. Mm-hmm. I mean, we've gotten so wrecked for so long. It's hard to still be bearish. I don't know about you.
No, I agree. It's been a bloodbath for months now. So
yeah, and volume is, you know, volume's kind of sticking around. Like it's a lot of trading. It's just not, there's a lot, you'll hear the new money thing every day, right? Oh, where's the new money? When's the new money coming? It's institutional money. I'm sick of hearing the word institutional. That's not what we're waiting on. Like it's a combination of things, but that same friend who like asked me like, oh, well, how have you found success? And I'm like, oh, well, you can short Bitcoin. Like, what? You can make money if it goes down? And so many people just aren't ready. They saw what happened and they either got wrecked or are scared of getting wrecked. And the reality is some of the better, like I know a guy who runs a pretty successful fund, like for the CME, not crypto. Like he's pretty good at what he does. And every day he's like, I'm just going to wait on that confirmation, man. And I'm like, come, that's not what good traders do. You are the confirmation. Like you predict the confirmation. He's like, I'm playing with $5 million, man. I can't just go in and we hit 4K. And he's got a point. And so I think that institutional money, and I want to talk about dark pools before we're over with, but that institutional money, maybe some of them are still kind of waiting on the sideline, you know, nice. They're waiting for confirmation. They're waiting for something to happen.
Well, let's go into dark pools because I think, you know, I remember when I was trading stocks a bit, this was something I was getting a little familiarized with back a few years ago. But I imagine for a lot of people in crypto who maybe haven't been down that road, they don't really know what they are. So let's chat a little bit about that.
Yeah. So for those who don't know what a dark pool is, essentially, and this exists in the equities market and it also exists in crypto. In fact, Kraken Exchange has a dark pool that you can register for, but you do have to, I'm pretty sure you have to be an accredited investor. I'm almost positive of that. But essentially, it's estimated that about 30% of the equities market is through dark pools of some sort. And basically,
the big volume.
Right. 20 to 30% of the equities traded in the US are through dark pools. And I think it's like 10% of all trades on EU equities are dark pools. And basically what a dark pool is it's a place where large volume, like high net worth individuals can trade essentially OTC, right? They can trade over the counter large amounts of an asset, in this case, Bitcoin or Ethereum or really anything, without affecting the exchange price and without that order being in any type of like order book, right? So it's basically, it's like an OTC deal without some of the sketchiness that comes along with meeting a guy at a restaurant with a bag of cash like you would on like local Bitcoins, right? And so dark pools are, they're going to be an increasing part of the cryptocurrency economy, in my opinion. When I think about institutional money and I think about some big people getting into this space, it's not likely that they're going to load up Coinbase Pro and load in $25-30 million or more, right? Some of these guys are playing with stupid money. They're not loading in $100 million into the order book to market buy BTC at $7,600. That's just not the way that works, right? And so dark pools make up, like I said, a fairly substantial part of the traditional equities market already. And it keeps those orders off the books. It keeps them a little bit more private. And it also keeps, most importantly, it keeps those orders from affecting the spot price, right, of Bitcoin or whatever the asset is that's being traded.
Well, and to me, like the biggest thing is just that, again, that slippage. You eliminate the slippage. And I think when you're dealing with big orders, that's such a big thing. Actually, for any of the Canadian listeners who might be looking for something like that, I've been kind of creeping around CoinSquare lately, and I actually believe they got a service like that available from what I've seen. Might be signing up there soon, so check it out potentially.
Yeah, and so I bring that up because when I was on the show last, I shilled a few coins, and I should have gone back and looked at what the price was when we aired that episode. But I can assure you that both Storm and Polly have done very well since I was a guest on the show. And so, you know, in true shit poster form, I want to make sure I give the people a gem. And for anyone who hasn't already heard me talk about it, because I haven't really blown it up a whole lot, is my gem right now is Republic Protocol. And that's The ticker symbol is REN, R-E-N. They're listed currently on one of the higher volume exchanges, OKX, but certainly not one of the prominent ones here in the West, right? It's not one that you hear a lot of your friends using. You can't register in the US unless you go through a VPN, and you have to exercise extreme risk. I'm not going to tell you how to beat the system, but if you sign up under VPN and you make the mistake of like confirming your just doing anything and not being under that VPN, they'll freeze your funds and then your shit's locked up on OKX. You got to do KYC and all this other stuff. REN protocol, token economics, off the top of my head, about $50 million market cap currently. So not like a total shit market cap, but essentially what they're doing is they are the dark pool for crypto. Like that's what they're looking to do.
Okay.
Circulating supply is about 500 million currently, and the price is about 10 cents, about 1200 sat, 1250 sat. And they recently, like I said, Kraken does this already, but Kraken does it for their own customers. What Republic protocol is doing is they recently rolled out this, and I just read it, so just forgive me if I'm a little bit confusing here, but they basically just rolled out this ability, this protocol that allows anyone to set up their own dark pool on their own exchange. So GDAX or Binance or Bittrex or whomever can essentially tap into the product that they built, this exchange, and they can offer these high liquidity dark pool deals, right? And these OTC essentially deals. And what's in it for the REN holder? Well, if you're a REN holder, you're able to essentially get a percentage of the fee that REN makes for doing these trades. And it's like a 0.2% fee, is the OTC fee. And you're able to get a percentage of that. If you're holding a node, essentially you're responsible for confirming and doing order matching, because it's a completely decentralized order book in the dark protocol. So it's, or in the dark pool rather. So, the token and kind of like the way that the underlying tech works is that, you as a node holder are responsible for basically confirming and matching a buyer and a seller. And every time that you're able to do that, you're able to collect a percentage of the fee for that deal. So, REN is definitely one worth checking out, doing some of your own research on. And that's one of my favorites right now. And it just so happens to be, trying to solve a problem in a part of the space that I think is super, super important. With these dark pools, I think are going to be more and more prominent. Do you know of any other services like that for crypto? I personally just haven't done enough research on it.
I do not. No, it's very. I was just going to say, like, I hadn't even heard of REN before this. But the interesting thing about doing this podcast too is it kind of makes up for some of the blind spots I get just from not being able to be in crypto 24/7. It's like the amount of cool projects that I've heard about on this podcast, or somebody, you know, shills it during a live chat or something during a live stream. It's ridiculous. And I wouldn't have found out about half of these if not for the podcast.
Well, hopefully your listeners are having the same experience. And, it's just sharing. This is not just like a shameless shill. Like, I'm not just shilling some shitcoin, right? Like, this is, I bought enough. They required that you have 100,000 REN, which is a little over a Bitcoin, in order to have a node. Their test net is to be released later this month, certainly in Q3. And then their main net is to be released, I think, by August. So they're going to be doing order matching and like everything's rolled out from a product standpoint very soon. So, I mean, this is definitely one that I think has massive upside as an investor, but also I think is solving a really unique and underserved kind of area within the crypto space, legitimizing it further because, as I already stated, 20-30% of equities trading is through some type of dark pool.
It's massive, runs the market.
Absolutely.
So something I want to touch on real quick too is last time we spoke about masternodes. I know you're pretty involved with those. Are there any that you're especially fond of right now? Any you're keeping an eye on? Just kind of walk us through your experience running masternodes over the past few months.
Yeah. So masternodes are something that I'm a kind of like a nerd fan for, that I don't have enough understanding of. But as an investor, I love the concept of them. And so I've set up different masternodes, or I've had someone set up different masternodes. And I've typically been a fan of the same few. Solaris, XLR is the ticker, is a privacy coin. and Zcoin as well as a privacy coin. Those are probably two masternodes that I'm going to really want to make sure I'm holding in 2020, especially Zcoin. I actually just interviewed the COO, Ruben Yap, of Zcoin and posted on my YouTube, and he was a really intriguing conversation. And so I think privacy coins will continue. I think the OGs prefer to call them Anon coins. I learned that from Not So Fast. Not privacy coins. So I want to make sure I'm using my terms right. Anon coins or Anon coins. I know that that's a huge, I think a very, very, very important diversification of my portfolios, and I'm holding privacy coins. And my favorite are Monero, Zcoin, and Solaris. And Zcoin and Solaris are two masternodes that I'm a fan of. And then REN, Republic Protocol, that I just addressed. Mm-hmm. I think that I did the math on a payout for a REN masternode if they hit their goals and if they're able to get anywhere near a significant market share of the dark pool market for crypto. And the payouts are going to be absolutely massive. I mean, we're talking about thousands of dollars a day. If down the road, we're talking 5 years down the road, they're able to be the player in the dark pool space. And so that's a masternode. So I bought enough to have a masternode whenever they roll that out, because that's going to be the third masternode that I'm going to run with. So those are the three, but you know, there's a ton of them out there, and with masternodes, you know, it's from an investment standpoint. I can't talk to it on a tech standpoint too well, but from an investment standpoint, it's supposed to be a decent way to get some recurring income from your investments, right? Do you guys hold any?
It's funny because I find there's a lot of coins that are kind of up and coming, say, that don't have masternodes working right now, but they are planning to kind of have them going in the future with their platform. So what I've been doing is I'll just buy enough for what the expected amount the masternode is going to be for these up and coming ones, and then I just sit and I wait. So that's what I've been doing.
Ven, Thor node, I know, has been very popular in a lot of talks lately, because Ven's mainnet is supposed to come out, I think, the end of this month. So Ven is one of my old babies. I loved Ven around 20 cents. Wrote it to about $20 and haven't really touched it since. So that might be another one that I'm looking at, because I personally think Ven has, like, you know, top 15 type potential in the market.
20 cents to $20?
I was going to say,
I not know about Ven. Yeah. Like, jeez.
The best part about time is that all we had was our free Telegram. And so everything is just out there in black and white. We put it out there. Like, it's, you can check me if you want. Search Bravado and Ven on Telegram and find it for yourself. It's out there. Yeah. So masternode's big fan, and looking to learn more. There's a couple guys in my community who are awesome, just absolute studs, and they're teaching me a lot about it. And so I'm trying to learn more about the tech side, right? I want to get a little bit nerdy, especially in a bear market. Like, what else is there to do? Play Legos, watch Netflix, learn masternodes.
This is the time. This is when you dig deep and you just try and learn as much as possible, so that when it comes down to the raging bull market, you know, you can kind of just sit back and say, okay, I've done all my, you know, it's like, okay, I put in so much work leading up to this point. Now I can maybe enjoy this a bit, but.
And that's why I'm not, quote, waiting for confirmation either. Like, my confirmation was the bounce when the market cap hit 250 billion, which, by the way, we started to try to, you know, look towards back in February. 250 billion, I said, all right, that's the target. I'm going in. And I went back in, and that's still my target. As long as the market's above that 250 billion, I'm going to be chilling. But I'm not trading. I think I made 6 trades in the last 2 weeks or something, most of which were BitMEX trades. So what else am I going to do but learn, you know, listen to great podcasts, learn about masternodes, drink some 40, you know, grams of protein whiskey.
It's funny how little trading I've done now. Like, you've mentioned it too, where, you know, you're not doing a lot of trading, and it, you know, you're coining that term, the swing hodler. Yeah, I like that. That's like such a perfect term for it, because, you know, I don't feel right calling myself a trader sometimes, because, I'll have friends who are like, oh, so what are you doing now? And I'm like, well, I don't know, I guess, you know, I technically, some people will call me a trader, but they're like, oh, you just sit around a computer and trade all day. I'm like, no, like, I don't do that. Like, I might make one trade a month or something. They're like, oh, well, oh, you're a trader? Or I'm like, well, I'm going to tell them I'm a swing hodler now.
It's like, well, what do you do all day? Well, I do some research, and then I mostly shitpost, right? I just mostly shitpost.
Yeah. I spend way too much time on crypto Twitter.
Crypto Twitter. And the thing is, like, the definition of a swing trader is, I mean, I don't know the book definition, but basically you're holding trades for like 6 to 8 weeks sometimes, right? And so, like, that is basically a hodl. So, I mean, I guess it's the same thing. But for me, First of all, if anyone asks what I do now, especially Uber drivers, because they're all bag holders like galore, I'm just a digital assets consultant and or a digital assets trader. And then they literally do not ask me another question after that. Yeah. Oh, okay. Where are you going?
I like that. Sounds extremely highbrow, you know, like digital asset consultant.
9 out of 10 Uber drivers are showing you Blockfolio within 5 minutes. Like they're ready to go.
Well, I remember, like, I don't have LinkedIn anymore, but I did have a LinkedIn account. I remember, like, you know, I had it like, okay, yeah, trading crypto. And like, just from having crypto in your name on LinkedIn, be prepared for just a flood of scammers to just swarm you. So I ended up changing it to digital asset trader. And sure enough, they slowed right down. But, you know, deleted that account now. But yeah, it was a funny little experiment.
Hell yeah. I love it. So yeah, just if you're out there and you're listening and you want to know how to get all the groupies off your back, you just let them know that you trade digital assets and that you're in a bear market and they'll leave you alone.
Yeah, I'm having that problem. Did you set up your masternodes yourself?
No. So Tony Crypto, I got to give him a quick shout out, Coin Caller on Twitter. He's one of my business partners and friends. And he basically, he's the one who got me in. So he got me in, started with a Mu masternode, and Mu is one of Natso's favorite old coins, monetary unit for those who are not familiar. Mm. And so honestly, like with the, cause I only have the two, and then I have enough for the third for Ren. And so for both of those, he just sets them up. He showed it to me on his computer. He sets up, cause we're basically running it together. So we're business partners. We do a lot of things together. So again, from a tech perspective, like I'm pretty ignorant to the entire process. I like the money and I like the idea of it. So it's something I'm still learning more about.
Yeah. That's been the main thing that's kept me away from them so far is I've looked into them a million times. I think it's an amazing idea depending upon the coin. But you look at how to set these things up and it's like hieroglyphics, dude. I mean, I'm not computer savvy, but it still seems very tough.
I gotta ring up my younger brother. I'm like, hey man, okay, I got some work for you to do. Get this node set up and I'll pay you at the end of the profits, like cash out. And usually that's literally how we work. And it's like whenever I have something that I, you know, whether it be a proof of stake coin or something, I just, you know, I'll ring the brother up and I'm like, okay, man, here we go. Get this set up and you can make a profit if you just run it and don't get hacked.
Yeah, no doubt. There's actually a couple of resources for beginners though that are out there. You guys probably know Panama Crypto on Twitter, Panama TJ. Mm-hmm. He has a pretty good guide on setting up a masternode that he put out not too long ago. So check that out. And then also there are masternode like third-party service like that, what they'll basically set up your masternode for you. And again, I don't know a lot of the intricacies because I have not used them before, but there's one that's called Masternode Me, I believe, like masternode.me. But basically just Google masternode hosting services and you can find different sources that are out there that will actually set it up for you.
I think at one point I had some, because you mentioned Mu and Mu has like where they have the masternode shares too, where so you don't actually need to own a full masternode. You can have just a portion and you can get shares in a masternode. I remember actually at one point I had a bunch of shares in a masternode, I think enough to just make like half of one or something like that. But yeah, I thought that was pretty cool. They just had a platform for it and it was super easy.
Yep. And you're going to see more of that come out, right? You're going to see more and more of these services that come out that continue to solve some of these problems. And that's kind of what I'm excited about.
Mm-hmm.
What do you guys do? I don't mean to sidetrack or take control by any means, but I do have a question as to what do you think about the market cap, right? So we're at this $350 billion level. When you think towards the future, you think a couple of years out, like how big are we going here?
It's tough, right? Because I don't like to be the guy who starts saying, oh, we're going to, you know, it's going to be crazy, right? Like we're going to have a 20 trillion market, you know, 30 trillion market, you know, and I don't want to say those things. For me, it's like, okay, well, first milestone to me is if we can get to like, 1 trillion, break that.
Yeah, I think it's very tough to look at it in aggregate and go, oh, all of these different services that address all these different needs, what could we possibly get to? What's like a decent, reasonable market cap, you know? And so I think what I'd like to do with that is simplify certain sectors of the market, let's say privacy coins, which I think in and of itself is a $10 to $15 trillion market. Mm-hmm. Let's take location services like XYO, which we mentioned earlier, like, you know, 10 or 20 episodes ago. Anyway, location services, that's another like trillion, like $10 trillion market. And so I think if you just even just take those two examples, you know, which are a tiny subsect of the entire crypto ecosphere, that should bode for a really large market cap. I mean, how quickly are we going to get there? I have no idea. I think within 2 years, we should be over 1.5 or 2 trillion or like a few trillion minimum, but it's hard to say, mm-hmm. you know? This stuff is very tough to figure out when you're first getting involved. And so it kind of takes a while.
The first thing people, I agree totally. And I just like to, I always like to just ask that question. It's been on my mind. I've been interviewing people lately. So I just wanted to take the seat for a quick second, see what you guys thought. But I won't railroad you anymore. But I do hear a lot of people try to compare it to the stock market, right? And they'll say, I don't know. I mean, the global stock market is, I think, in the neighborhood of $80 trillion globally. So mm-hmm. people say, oh, well, the stock market is $80 trillion. We're only $400 billion. Like, we have all this upside. While I think that's true, and I think tokenized securities is a 2019, late 2018 mm-hmm. play for sure, that's not where crypto, I think, blows up. Most people are not familiar with like the derivatives market, and basically, that's a $1,200 trillion. So I think like yeah. $1.2 quadrillion global yeah. market. It's absolutely massive, and then you can tokenize everything, and you can mm-hmm. bet. And essentially, that's what it is. I mean, usually people are in derivatives as a hedge against like their yeah. traditional investment, right? So, I mean, if that's what you're looking at, total scope. I don't know that you just tokenize securities. That's not that sexy. Like, people are not so interested in tokenizing securities, but people are 100 times interested in betting. People yeah. want to make bets. And in the derivatives market, you can tokenize bets against any underlying asset, whether it be precious metals. I've learned of these tokens that are backed by gold, backed by companies by way of a security, backed by other cryptocurrencies, like ones that are a store of value. So, you know, long term, you know, I think we're all so early in the space.
Oh,
and yeah. I'm bullish. I'm bullish, boys.
It's hard not to be bullish, right? Like, I wouldn't be here if I wasn't bullish. So
I know people are like, do you think it's going to go up? Obviously, because I haven't sold.
Yeah. I wouldn't be here if I thought it was a waste of time. So. Right.
Or I'm just bag holding now at this point. I'm like I said, I'm willing to go down with the ship. It's better than not getting on.
We're all just convincing ourselves it'll go back up, right? Yeah. Come on, everybody. Obviously, right?
It has to be in an archive in the Smithsonian one day. Like, look at these fucking idiots.
Delusion. Yeah.
I think this year in crypto, and really like 2017 was like this as well for me, was sort of a regime change in terms of my overall thoughts on crypto. When I first got involved, I was thinking, okay, I mean, I don't really see a huge use case for all this stuff, but I can maybe make some money and get out. And I think that really changed over the past year, year and a half, where now I'm really thinking like, this is very legit. Like, there's enough, you know, business being built around it. There's enough activity. There's enough capital coming into it. Enough legitimate use cases where it's not going away. It's not going to zero. A couple of people we've spoken with, older traders, they were saying that, you know, in 2013, 2014 even, there was a thought, you know, what if this all just goes away? Like, what if this is a complete mirage? And I think we're out of that, at least.
And that was so much more likely back then. Like, that's yeah. terrifying. I have so much respect for the people who bag held through that first, through yeah. like, my God, there's that old adage, like, oh, if you bought $100 worth of Bitcoin back in whatever, you'd have $416 trillion. And it's like, the reality is, if you bought $100 of Bitcoin back in 2012, you sold half of it at $1,000 and you lost the other half of Mt. Gox. That's what happened.
Yeah, or you were spending it on the, Silk Road, or you were betting with it online. And that was pretty much it. Like, people weren't, it wasn't really like a huge investment thing at first, right? And it's kind of, you know, like the guys say back then, they literally weren't sure if they were going to wake up the next day and there would still be markets going, you know, but I think now we're kind of past that stage. So
no doubt about it. I do not disagree.
So I think we've covered a lot of good topics. Birch, amazing guest as always. Is there anything else you want to impart on the listeners? Anything else you want to add or talk about?
No, I think we probably got our point across for this here episode. We don't want to give the people too much good information. Otherwise, you won't have me back for a third. But I will say a couple of things just as a parting thing. For those of you who don't know me, you know, welcome and thank you for your future support. But move slow, be patient. And on, for those of you on crypto Twitter, just be kind. I have seen so much just reckless salt, just complete trash that was crypto Twitter's. It was always fun in that way, but it's gotten to a point where it's just almost not worth participating in some days. And I try to stay out of people's hair usually, but for those of you who are out there, just remember, like, we are all in this together. Like, we are all crazy degenerates together, and we may have differing opinions on different shit coins, or some of you may be better traders than me and disagree with my symmetrical triangle. That's okay. I'm not going to be, my feelings will not be hurt. But let's work together to better the space, and let's just continue to appreciate what we have, because I really truly believe that we are all at the beginning of something really, really special. And so for me, like, if I have any parting words, just keep that in mind. Like, you have the benefit, the luxury, to participate in something that could very well be completely reformative, like completely change everything. So just keep that in mind while you're out there interacting with other people, especially those people like you gentlemen who are just putting out content all the time, working your ass off. And a lot of us aren't doing it for very much money. You know, we actually do make money trading, and just try to keep that in mind. You know, that's just kind of my PSA. But I always appreciate the thoughts, and I appreciate you guys having me on as always. It really means a lot. I love doing it.
Awesome parting words. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank this you again, awesome. Dude. Awesome episode. Everybody, you'll probably hear this on Thursday or Friday. So have a great weekend.
Tip your waitress.
Thanks for listening as always. We'll catch you all next time. Peace.